right. That is Kendrick Lamar music from Black Panther. Excuse me. We are going to be talking today about Black Panther. We're going to be talking about Chris Rock's new comedy special. We're going to be talking about Fergie's NBA All-Star Game debacle. Joining me are Tanisha Dugan, producing associate at TheaterWorks, Rich Holland, principal and design director at CoLab, and a commissioner on cultural affairs for the city of Hartford, Kate Rushen, a poet who teaches writing and literature for Hartford Youth Scholars. I am your host, Whitey.
Welcome to a very black episode of The Nose.
That's right. So
we're going with black.
Yeah, we're going with I said people of color during the billboard. Somebody texted in an objection to that right away. So you can't go right. That's the key. All right. So we all went to see Black Panther on it was a very, very busy movie weekend for Black Panther. It has broken some box office records and come close to breaking other ones. The soundtrack that you just heard, the album, is also a big hit right now. There are lots and lots of ways in which this feels like it could be, anyway, something very, very pivotal. So we're going to start there and then go to Chris Rock. And then so you won't have to listen to Fergie for a while. I'm just promising. I'm promising you that you won't have to, and that then you will. So I just want to maybe just, you know, take everybody's temperature here on Black Panther generally. I know at least one of you. Did anybody besides Kate see it more than once?
No.
All right. Well, Kate, since you saw it twice, you get to go first. I just made up that rule.
All right. Well,
that's what white people do. We make up rules. You
know. All right.
On the spot.
Starting it right.
That's how whitey do.
All right. Speaking of white people and Black Panther, I'll start off by saying it was kind of fun and funny to see white characters playing the sidekick comic relief role.
Martin Freeman, we should say, plays sort of a friendly, goofy, semi dopey CIA agent.
Yeah, and
the CIA agent's been so great in Africa.
Yes,
they played such a positive role there.
But I enjoyed that humor. I enjoyed all the inside jokes. I actually wasn't expecting humor, and I thought a lot of it was funny. And people I saw it with in the audience thought it was funny as well. I do not know the entire history of Black Panther and Wakanda. I have not read all of the comics from 1966, and I really enjoyed it, really had a great time. And I love the shout-out to Grace Jones as the precursor to Afrofuturism. Mm-hmm. I love the look, and I love the style.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we should say Black Panther introduced as a comic book character, actually before the Black Panther movement started in America. And now that I tell you that, you probably also can guess that for a while, Marvel changed his name to Black Leopard and had – this is true, actually. This is true. And then had him as a character in the comic book explain that he was changing his name because he didn't want to get too political. So there you go. All right. Tanisha, you're up.
That's interesting that that happened, considering that I think the movie actually tries to be very political. And it succeeds in some ways and fails in others. I had a good time too. You know, it's a comic book movie. It's probably not like the greatest comic book movie I've ever seen. And I was actually talking to a friend who saw it as well. And my experience was the sound wasn't like what I am accustomed to. Mm-hmm. It didn't sort of wrap me. And maybe that was Ryan's purpose, Ryan Coogler, the director, to sort of bring it down to a more human scope. I don't know. But for what it is and what it's doing, I'm really, really excited by it.
Before we go to Rich, I just want to say, yes, directed by Ryan Coogler, whose previous work has been Fruitvale Station and Creed. Creed, I thought was an amazing post-cursor to Rocky and maybe pre-cursor to this. He works with Michael B. Jordan, the actor in all of his movies. Michael B. Jordan plays, I would not exactly say the villain in this, but certainly the character who's in opposition to the hero, if that makes you the villain. Let's play a little clip from this before we go to Rich. You're going to hear a discussion. You're going to hear the hero of this movie himself, played by Chadwick Boseman, talk about how to deal effectively with the villain named Claw. Claw? Claw, yes.
Claw.
Claw. Claw. Claw, something.
Ulysses Claw plans to sell the vibranium to an American buyer in South Korea tomorrow night.
Claw has escaped our pursuits for almost 30 years. Not capturing him is perhaps my father's greatest regret. I wish to bring Klaw back here to stand trial.
Wakanda does not need a warrior right now. We need a king.
My parents were killed when he attacked. Not a day goes by when I do not think about what Klaw took from us. From me.
It's too great an opportunity to pass.
Take me with you. We'll take him down together, side by side.
They need you here, protecting the border.
Then I ask, you kill him where he stands, or you bring him back to us?
You have my word. I will bring him back.
You also hear the voices of Daniel Kaluuya, whom you first met in Get Out. He's playing a character named Wakabi, apparently a friend to T'Challa, the leader of this tribe. And you're also hearing the fabulous Danai Gurira as Okoye. You know her probably best as Michonne from The Walking Dead. She's also a pretty interesting playwright whose work has been done at Yale Rep. So, Rich.
Wait, before Rich hops in, I want to say I love that you picked this clip because the accents give us such a beautiful sort of understanding of the Pan-Africanism, and I think you get to hear it on radio in a way that you don't get to hear it see it on TV. So well done, you guys. That's a really beautiful way to show us all that.
All right. I'm going to pretend that we had a lot of other clips to choose from and accept that compliment. anyway, go ahead.
So this was beautiful, first of all. And as a testament to Black is Beautiful, this lived up to that completely. I appreciated the film processing technology in that that made Black people look amazing for once. I mean, to think about the legacy that we came from where film and video was actually really crafted for white complexions and leaving Black folks literally in the shadows all the time. That to me is one of the most resonating things about this movie. Every statement that's made about it, however literal you're trying to be, ends up being symbolic by nature. Mm-hmm. And that works in a lot of ways. I thought that this was beautiful and spectacular. I think that the challenge with the hype around this movie is that it's being sold as hype. And it's not a hype at all. This is first step. Mm-hmm. And as first step, it's very, very legitimate and worth watching. If there's one thing that I absolutely would want to change about it right now, is I desperately wanted this thing to end with Wycliffe singing Wakanda, Wakanda.
So, you know, Tanisha, you said comic book movie, and it is. It's a comic book movie based on a comic book character. It has so many other ambitions layered over that. I don't think there have been a lot of comic book movies. And as you say, there may have been some comic book movies that, you know, in some ways, you know, executed that form more effectively or more excitingly than this. Because this thing has so many other ambitions. As you say, a lot of political dialogue going in there, a lot of philosophical dialogue going on in there. I don't know. I feel like he's bitten off a really big chunk, Ryan Coogler, and then the question is like can he really do all those things in 2 hours plus? How does he do?
You know, it's interesting. I think, you know, I press against the word ambition in the same way that you do about hype, because I think you know when you're taking on something of this stature, right? A $200 million budget. For a guy whose films have been, you know, in the $5 to $10 million range, you know what you're going into. And interestingly enough, this project was actually Ava DuVernay's before Ryan. Exactly. Before Ryan stepped in. And so I think, yes, there was an understanding that this was major. There was an understanding that here is this script that laid out some given circumstances that we had never experienced before. A setting in Africa, an all-Black list of characters. And what does that mean when you take that on? What do you have to accomplish when you do that? And I think some of the basic things, like making sure that it's beautiful, making sure that this medium does us right. And I think Black is the appropriate way to talk about us because it is Pan-African. It does cover all of the kinds and types and styles and colors of Blackness. I think, you know, he had a lot he had a lot of history. He was really dug into the ancestors, as this movie so beautifully talks about. And so maybe that's the thing instead of ambition. There was the honoring our ancestors, the story that came before us that he was trying to put forth. And I think that he is successful in that. I think we live in a weird political climate where it's hard to do that well. And some of that, I think, bled into it for me and making it maybe not as successful in some places. But I think he honored the ancestors in trying to be as ambitious in this project.
I'm also wondering how big a change this is going to bring about. I mean, the box office success of this thing proves all kinds of stuff, not only that a black audience will support this movie, but that a white audience will support this movie. The latest market thing that I saw was 37% of the audience is black. And you just sort of wonder, you know. I mean, I think it's impossible to know, Kate, right now, but it seems as though it might mean a different kind of pop cultural I mean, everybody wants to make $235 million in their first four-day weekend, so I'm guessing other people are going to go chase this rabbit.
Well, I certainly hope that it represents a real change. And I guess what I want to say about it is that representations do matter, even in comics. And while this movie deals with honoring the ancestors, which I think is beautiful, it's not only searching for a mythic past, but it's projecting mm-hmm. black people mm-hmm. into the future, mm-hmm. which is a big new thing that we haven't seen on the big screen in quite the same way.
Technology on Earth created by black people, yeah.
Right. Absolutely. And the last time I saw folks raising money to send black children to the movie theater was not the time before Black Panther that I remember seeing that was for Malcolm X. Mm. And if we take a study of contrast of these two movies, I'm going to argue that that Black Panther operated in the context of politics, mm-hmm. But didn't touch right. politics in any way, shape, or form. In a lot of ways, I believe that I feel like the black story was kind of cleansed a bit mm-hmm. to make it more acceptable. For a broader audience.
You should say a little bit more about I know because of the emails that we sent. I think I know anyway what you mean by this. Let me just set you up just to so Michael B. Jordan in this plays, as I said, the person who at least whose ideas and goals are very different from those of the hero and therefore I guess he kind of is the villain. But like a lot of Marvel comic universe heroes, but more so than ever, he plays this guy whose name is kind of loaded up, Eric Killmonger, but he plays this as a guy who has a vision that's not entirely a negative one. I don't want to spoil too much of this for people who haven't seen this movie, but it's not entirely a negative one, and it's one that people walk out of the movie theaters going, well, you know, Eric was really right about a lot of that stuff. You know, he wasn't completely off base in some of the things that he was saying. You set it up in our emails as a Martin and Malcolm dynamic.
Yeah, that's what I saw it playing out there. The ideologies of our hero in this story, Chala, was particularly Malcolm. It had a lot of acceptability politics around it. Mm-hmm. It was a black man who was who preferred isolation and separatism to revolution and antagonism. So there were a lot of those dynamics that were going on that allowed us to take a look at a powerful black human as a non-threatening entity mm-hmm. to white people. Mm-hmm. Whereas, in a lot of ways, it aligned with Martin, right? And then we take a look at Eric Killmonger. And he aligned so perfectly well to me with Malcolm. Mm-hmm. And there was a verdict in the movie about what's acceptable. That we may agree that Killmonger's may be right, but he's not right for right now. Hmm. And to me, I'm still longing for the change to come when we can sell this much in tickets and end it with Eric was right.
Mm. Two things. One, I love where you're thinking, and that was sort of I struggled with this dynamic a bit because Eric also was represented by an African American, mm-hmm. right? So that perspective was distinctly of a Black American perspective or point of view.
I just want to clarify what you're saying. The character actually is African American.
Exactly.
He's a character who's grown up in America.
Correct. While the other characters are African. And that was probably one of the things that stuck with me when I left. I thought, oh, that's interesting, this idea that the Killmonger is a Black American, the idea that the revolutionary is a Black American makes sense, but that he is sacrificed ultimately mm-hmm. was interesting to me. And then the second point to your thing about the narrative, right? Yes, this movie made a lot of money, but what it brings to the table to me is this idea of, are we ready for narratives that look like this to continue to be told over and over again? Yes, this movie made a lot of money. Yes, it made a lot of money because of the construct around it, that it is a comic book movie. Are we ready to allow the culture to broaden in a way that includes these stories truly? Or is this a one-off? Is this another kind of circus act in that way?
Well, Kate, we might get an answer when Ryan Coogler and Michael B. Jordan move on to their next movie, which is called Wrong Answer. It's about the Atlanta school cheating scandals with a Ta-Nehisi Coates screenplay. It won't be anything like Black Panther.
Yeah, I'm really glad that we have this other movie, this serious movie based in history coming out. From that team after Black Panther, rather than going right to the next blockbuster sequel. But I wanted to get back to something that Rich said. I'm glad you brought up Malcolm X, that Spike Lee's Malcolm X. I have seen it again, and I feel the same way I felt at the beginning. They was robbed mm-hmm. of their Oscar nominations. Mm-hmm. If not winning outright, I think they won for costume or something like that. And it would be really interesting to look at Spike Lee's Malcolm X now in alongside of Black Panther. And I think one thing that I think we can't – I know we're going to talk about it that added to the power of Black Panther is that the women in the film – have their own power or as powerful as the men. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where a lot of the power of the movie comes from.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about that now, too. Yes, we have Lupita Nyong'o, of course, Yale Drama School graduate and someone we, I think, first met in 12 Years a Slave. I've already mentioned Dene Gurira, Angela Bassett. So Tanisha, as she's saying, some really, really great and very powerful women characters.
Amazing women characters. And, this movie has been a great opportunity for cosplay for Black people. It's been something that we've participated in forever, but to be able to do that in characters that look exactly like us is really exciting. Yeah, I love that.
I was just seeing if you had anything on in particular. Right
well,
now.
I was going to.
You have
I had totally planned on it.
You have your vibranium necklace.
I do have my vibranium necklace. And then I got dressed this morning and completely forgot. So I was planning on dressing up for this occasion. But I love that. I love that these women stand on their own. They challenge their men. They are partners, equal partners with them. It's an amazing thing. And I want to clarify something about this sort of idea of circus act. Part of the reason I think Black Panther has made so much money is on the backs of Black people and Black money. Mm-hmm. And so I'm actually curious if – I know we'll come out for the next Ryan Coogler, Michael B. Jordan film. We will. And we will probably come out within the same amount of financial dollars we're going to support. I'm actually curious whether our kin, our brethren who are of lighter skin tones, who are less melanated, will continue to support this work, to support these narratives in this way.
Yeah, first of all, I do think we're going to have to switch topics here fairly soon, Rich, but I do feel as though Ryan Coogler and Michael B. Jordan are right now the Scorsese and De Niro of their moment. I mean, I want to see anything that they work on together. I feel like Michael B. Jordan is a very unusual actor in that, like, not only have I enjoyed everything, pretty much everything he's ever done except, you know, some dismissible popular entertainment movies, but, like, I know the name of every character he ever played. He was Wallace in The Wire, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
He was Vince on Friday Night Lights. Like, I just, you know, there's something about him, right? You just, he makes you know him as an actor.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It makes you know him. And he wears his emotions on his face, and you can't erase that. And he's, in my lens, unapologetically black. Mm-hmm. And that's a lovely thing to see. Yeah, I don't have much more to add to that.
Well, speaking of unapologetically black, maybe we should segue right off the back of that into Chris Rock. Chris Rock has a brand new special out released onto Netflix called Tambourine. Actually, maybe we could just begin by hearing a clip from Tambourine. Here he is talking about bringing one of his daughters to school for orientation day. He's also talking about the need, he thinks, for bullies.
So I'm at the school, and the lady comes back out. She goes, I want you to know that the school has absolutely no bullies. We have a no-bully policy. We don't permit bullying. Any bullies will be kicked out of school immediately. And right then, I wanted to take my daughter out to school. I was like, what kind of half-ass education is this? We need bullies. Bullies do half the work. That's right. Teachers do one half. Bullies do the whole other half. And that's the half you're gonna use as a grown-up. I'm telling you, we need bullies. That's why there's so many fat kids in school right now. Because there's nobody to take their lunch money. You know what they buy with all that money? Seconds. We need bullies, man. That's how Trump became president. That's exactly what happened. We got rid of bullies, a real bully showed up, and nobody knew how to handle it.
So there's Chris Rock. By the way, I'm sitting here in the studio on the nose with Tanisha Dugan, Rich Holland, and Kate Rushin. We had differing reactions to this special. It's a special that, in a way, I don't know, as I've gone back over it getting ready today, I found myself liking parts of it that I didn't really like very much the first time I heard them. But Tanisha, you straight up, you liked this.
I did. I laughed. I laughed so hard. I cried. Maybe not that part. But I did. I mean, I guess I should say that my sense of humor probably tends to, in this realm. You know, I'm sure there are people listening who heard this bullying section and were appalled. I actually think he's spot on right. So I should at least explain that that's where I sit to begin with. So all of this is just sort of truth telling that I like to hear. But I think, you know, and I was teasing these guys, but I do think that I may sit in a different place and am able to appreciate it because he is not literally my peer. And so I'm not mining it for any there are some truths to my life that I see, but I'm not trying to match it perfectly to the moment that I'm in that is also parallel to his. And so I think I have a separation from it in a way that allows me to see it as funny that, you know, some folks who have lived more than I, who have seen more turns around the sun, have not enjoyed as much.
Well, I mean, I think one thing, Rich, is sort of undeniable here is he's in a more pained and painful place than we've ever seen him in before. He is talking very frankly about the circumstances of his divorce, sometimes very self-laceratingly about the circumstances of his divorce, talking also about porn addiction, his own porn addiction, in a way that you typically don't hear people talk. We're meeting a slightly different version of this guy we've known for so long.
We are meeting a slightly different version, and I just don't feel like he met us. He was talking about his porn addiction. He was talking about, you know, about tambourining and how one behaves as a second in a relationship. And you know, the entire time, the guy felt like he was speaking about a foot behind where he was standing, that he was using his entire body as a shield from telling the truth, from telling a deeper truth and being real in it. I think that Chris Rock is particularly at his best when he's delivering commentary. And I think to embed it in Tanisha's point, a place where I really love Chris Rock is when I'm not sure if he's telling me what he really thinks or if he's playing the opposite game with me and telling me what he really thinks at the same time, when I just really can't tell if he's being straight with me. And when he does that intentionally, it's fabulous. You know, when he's hiding, it doesn't feel so fabulous any longer, and that's where he loses me.
Kate, give me your thoughts.
Yeah, so first of all, I would say that the thing about live performance is that the performer is having to make a connection with their audience. And so I think watching a filmed live performance already puts us at a remove. And I'm sure that Chris Rock was probably connecting with the people in the room with him, but it, some of it didn't carry to me. I laughed, but sometimes he struck me as kind of an embittered uncle. And with some of the jokes, I almost expected him to go like Henny Youngman on us and say, like, take my wife. And I did not appreciate the fact that he used his daughter's real names and that some of the name checks he had in his little sex jokes were women that we know, like Halle Berry, Rihanna, Aretha. I don't know his history with Rihanna. Maybe there was more truth to that. But
or Aretha.
Or Aretha.
Yeah, we don't want to spoil that joke for you, but he does set up a joke by saying, I was at a party with Rihanna recently, which is a hard place to bring us with you too.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
Yeah. So when I looked at it again, I think I appreciated more, but I think I felt like I was almost seeing a ghost of Chris Rock.
Yes.
I wonder if part of my ability to, because I don't think that you're wrong. I actually think that that's one of the things that's compelling. And I'm looking at Rich when I say I don't think you're wrong, because I think that part of him hiding is actually really interesting. To the same way that like that part of him name-checking people is very interesting to me in the world we live right now, where like you can find that information if you want to. He can not say the names if that makes us feel better in the live moment, but we could easily go and figure out who he's talking about.
And we probably did. Too.
And we probably, yeah.
I did anyway.
Exactly. And I we are all hiding in plain sight. Mm-hmm. And I kind of loved that dynamic in this piece, that he is talking about where he wants to be and sometimes saying it as if this is where he is. But I appreciated that tension.
I think for me, yes. And so that's a cool tension when it works. And there were moments in this piece where it actually worked really well. And I felt him and I laughed and he just felt like he came together with himself. But then there's a bulk of it that just when this guy is talking about the struggle, you know, and when he's talking about in one breath that to legitimize himself in the courts, he bought a multi-million dollar mansion around the corner from his wife, and then starts talking about sending his kids out with the truth about what the black struggle is in America. I'm like, dude, come on.
But I think about LeBron James this weekend, right? Mm-hmm. I think about LeBron James coming out and being like, yeah, I have this $1 million house, but they still sprayed nigger on my fence.
Right.
So I think he can have both of those things be true.
Well, I think that's been one of his great kind of Uber jokes for decades, right? It is, look at me. I'm incredibly successful. I'm incredibly rich. I'm incredibly well-loved. And he's talking to the white people in the audience, and he said, and you still wouldn't trade places with me, would you?
Right.
That's been one of his great lines.
Kate, the
dentist thing is like one of my favorite things that he's ever done. Kate, this time, to Rich's point, I thought, I'm not sure he would trade places with us at this point. You know, I mean, he seems a little bit, even though talking about his divorce, he says, I'm talking to you from hell right now. That obviously is a very fresh hell for him. But, you know, in the rest of his life, I mean, to Rich's point, I sort of thought,
he's
Chris Rock now.
Yeah, you know, I felt that I was watching a grown man struggling with what it means to be a black man in America and struggling with his own sense of his own masculinity. And I felt that maybe it was a little bit too soon. Mm-hmm. I mean, he had to fulfill his Netflix contract, but you know, maybe a little bit down the line, he'll have worked out some of this for himself more.
Yeah,
I think you hit on something. And he actually posted a picture of him, Chris Tucker, Kevin Hart, and Dave Chappelle. And the comment is, I don't know who's opening, but Dave is definitely the closer.
Yeah.
And so I think he's really aware of the fact that, like, yes, I think the Netflix money came and he was like, got to do this live show. And I think he probably needed a couple more outings to really like craft the story, because the tambourine thing is a little pat, right? Like, in the way that Dave sort of circles back around his sort of joke in a way that is just really well crafted. So I think he gets that. And I like process. I mean, I spend my life watching live performers all the time. Yeah. So I'm like into the failure.
Right. I think we have to take a break here. I'll just say one of my – you've got me thinking about the fact that Chappelle, who I think has been pretty brilliant in these last two specials, doesn't – he seems like he doesn't care whether anybody likes him or not. Mm-hmm. This is like – this is me. I got over that whole idea of whether you like me or not a long time ago. For Chris Rock, I think he's still kind of on that journey. He's actually introducing the audience to ways in which he doesn't like himself and maybe they won't like him either.
And he's still referencing the fact that he didn't finish high school or only went as far as high school. And I'm like, after all this, dude, you're going back
to
high school?
So we got to take a quick break because we promised you Fergie. That's in our contract. We got to do it. I feel as though my life as an American has included many, many conversations about various people singing the national anthem, what people think of as the wrong way, Aretha Franklin at national conventions. Take your pick. Yeah, Jose Feliciano. I think, Kate, you brought that up in one of the emails. And actually, maybe just to set this up before we get to Fergie, let's hear. I will not forget for a long time. In 1983, I was watching as a fan the NBA All-Star game. Marvin Gaye came out to sing the national anthem. He was about 1 year out from having released Sexual Healing, which is not an unimportant thing to know as you listen to this version.
Can you see by the dawn's early what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's
lane. Prior to that, I would have said you couldn't have sex to the national anthem. But
I mean, yes, you heard the panties dropping as the women yelled and screamed.
Is that what you
in
heard?
The background?
I thought that was the national anthem straight out of Lion King. It was amazing.
Oh, my God. So ridiculous.
So that was then. That was the NBA All-Star game in 1983. Here is the NBA All-Star game in 2018.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the
all right. It gets worse, actually. It gets quite a bit worse. And that was not Maya Rudolph deliberately messing up the national anthem. That was Fergie. Fergie, she of the Black Eyed Peas. And, you know, it just, like, my favorite thing about this was the noise Rich made. So maybe you should have the first word here.
So I knew it was going to be bad. I didn't get a chance to hear it. And wow, this is awful. This is ill-advised, to
exactly.
say the least.
Exactly. I mean, that is the question.
I mean,
right?
You had to run that
where
by somebody.
Where are her people?
Like,
where are her people?
Where
were her people?
Song.
Where were her people?
There you go.
Oh, you have to stop this.
Because we're getting to the point that's been now auto-tuned into its next meme.
Yeah.
You gotta hear that.
You know, I think Fergie was trying to channel Billie Holiday, and Lady Day refused to show up.
I think you're right. I think she doesn't actually have the facility to pull this off. And I mean, I'm so glad you gave us the Marvin Gaye version, because at least we see there's like a history. So distracting. So, like, at least we have a history of these kinds of remakes, because I couldn't quite figure out why it was even necessary. But I think knowing that this is like a thing to reimagine how and what style to do the national anthem, the problem is she just couldn't pull it off. She just does not have the technical facility to sing it in the style of jazz.
That would be problem one. I would say another part of this, I mean, once again, as we talk, my thoughts are congealing a little bit better. I mean, I think, you know, for Jose Feliciano to overlay any kind of Latin or flamenco sound onto the national anthem is a pretty natural inborn choice, right. You know, and for Aretha Franklin to gospelize it is a natural inborn choice. Here, to your point, Kate, she's kind of trying to be somebody that she's not and she's not ever going to be.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. I do feel bad for her, because I did watch the tape and I saw her face after, and she really did. She really was trying her best. Mm. And she really thought she had nailed it.
This is why we need bullies. I'm just saying.
Well, or at least directors. I say at least directors and stage managers.
So I'm going to ask a question. And I know in my brain it sounds a little sarcastic, but I really don't mean it as sarcasm. What is the inborn natural choice for white people?
Sort of the rest of culture, basically. We just sort of get to take our pick. No, I think maybe the answer to that is, if I were advising Fergie, and as all of you have suggested, there's some question as to whether anybody advised her or how anybody could have heard that as a rehearsal, or how she could have done it in front of the mirror and not, you know, had some idea. I think you, in this case, what you do is you start by just, when you're practicing, you just sing the song exactly as it was written.
Sing it as it's written.
And then you can begin to ask yourself questions about what you can bring to this particular song. And I thought one of the things that – I mean, I think increasingly we live in an age where competitions like American Idol and The Voice have kind of wrecked singing anyway. Mm-hmm. Everybody thinks that they've got to do tons of melisma and just sort of over-ornamentation. The people who can just get up there and sing a song and bring out its pure musical qualities. Not that this song has any particularly laudable musical qualities.
And we won't even talk about the third verse.
No, or the fact that it's an English drinking song.
I think you're absolutely right that, like, no one sings a song straight up. And that would have been the most obvious choice. And this is a hard song to sing straight up.
Exactly. So if to be more specific about my question, right? The culture that Jose Feliciano leaned into is clear. Right. The cultural legacy that the deep roots of what Marvin Gaye leaned into, very, very clear. Mm-hmm. And I guess I'm getting to, if you're not appropriating, what are you doing in this instance?
Beverly Sills?
Right. Well, I mean, that was the question that we sort of danced around when we talked about how and why are we talking about Fergie doing this, and how or why does this relate to the other things we've talked about today. And I do think that is the dance that Fergie is doing. You know, she's been lauded for a long time as a white girl who is really comfortable singing in black sounds. And she's done it in a way that never felt like, or some would argue didn't feel like, she was appropriating. There's something about this new version of her. And she's not just doing it with the anthem. I mean, I've seen her in other places where the singing, the new album she's working on, or just come out or whatever, is very much in this sort of jazz road. And I think it's her trying to reinvent herself outside of sort of the sexualized pop star that most women have to lean into to survive. And, you know, she's a mom and, you know, she's a divorcee and all of the things that play in your mind about what does that mean? What does that look like? I think she's trying to rewrite who she is outside of the pop landscape. And I don't know what the options are, truly.
That's all good. But how did she get this job?
Because I think there's a good singer in there. I really do think there's
Christina
a good
singer. Aguilar?
Yeah.
The I think that the album you're talking about was released last year, and the only reason that I know that is that I encountered, as I was just sort of doing some research, such as it is for this particular segment, the phrase "long-awaited Fergie double album," and I thought, it made me think of last year John Oliver using the phrase the only phrase more off-putting than featuring Sting. I think we now know what that phrase is. All right, you know what? We should take a break so we'll have time to recommend some things, and we'll be back.
I was going to make a joke about, you know, what'll this do to sales of the Fergie Christmas album, but now I'm worried that maybe there really is a Fergie Christmas album. Can somebody else Google that? I'm scared of what I might find. Today's show was produced by Jonathan Panschala and me, Kyone Wolf. Amanda Fish stars in The Black Piranha. The part of Bill Curry was played by Andy Serkis. On Monday's show, we'll be back with news from over the weekend on The Scramble. And now, back to Colin.
All right. Here on this show, we like to recommend things to you towards the end here. Let's start over on this side with Rich Holland. What have you got?
I've got two quick ones. One is a 6-episode series of interviews with David Letterman on Netflix. It's called My Next Guest Needs No Introduction with David Letterman. I watched immediately after the Chris Rock bit, Letterman's interview with Obama. And Obama at this point transcends being interviewed. You just kind of bring him on, and he is himself, and it's refreshing. And they got to a piece of really honest truth with each other about legacy and luck towards the end of this thing that's worth watching just for that. Next up, I think, is George Clooney, and there's a host of really good folks there. The other thing I want to recommend to everybody in the spirit of what this week has been for me with Chris Rock and Black Panther and being on with Kate and Tanisha right now. go to discoveringdiversity.com. It's the website for the Discovery Center, who's an organization in Hartford working on racial equity. And they have workshops on diversity, on equity, diversity, and inclusion. They're really cheap and so powerfully transformative, whether you're a person of color or white or marginalized or right smack in the center. Well worth the time.
Awesome. All right, then. So, Tanisha, what have you got for us?
I got three. So the first one is an endorsement of love and of pressing. J.V. Harvey, he has a book, too, Steady Rain, which is an adult erotic thriller, and Harvey Little Brown Duck, which is a children's book. And he's going to be at the Barnes & Noble on Front Street on Wednesday. So that's my first endorsement. My second is I'm endorsing students because I've been really excited to see what's happening around gun laws, gun rights. So Emma Gonzalez for president. But also it is my hope that this doesn't become like the Arab Spring, where we see students rise up and make a stand and that we don't all rally around them and support, because we all believe in what they're saying. So let's all take courage and follow behind them. And my last one is Mary Poppins. Why Mary Poppins? Because I'm in an interesting time as a culture creator where people are asking for sugar. They want sugar, they want sugar, they want sugar. Please, the world is so hard. And I'm endorsing Mary Poppins because the sugar is to help the medicine. Let us continue to provide the medicine, even if it is with a dose of sugar.
So you're endorsing the movie Mary Poppins.
The movie, yes. Yeah. There's a new one coming out, but old one too. Yeah. Yes, a new one with Emily Blunt.
The books are also the books are really different. I grew up with the books. I loved the books. They were not sugary.
Yeah,
And I really truly loved them as a kid. Anyway, yeah. Kate, what have you got?
All right. So tomorrow I'm part of a forum public discussion sponsored by the Hartford Public Library, the Amistad Center, and the Wadsworth Athenaeum, on the Big Read book for 2018, Citizen and American Lyric by Claudia Rankine. And people can go to faculty@wadsworthathenaeum.org or the Hartford Public Library website for information. And inspired by Black Panther, I looked up the so-called Dahomey Amazons and their history. They were the historical basis for the women guards, king's guards.
We're called the – I now know. I can now tell you they're called the Dora Milaje.
Yes. And so you can go online and find out about them. And the last so-called Dahomey Amazon actually lived until the 1970s. Also, please go to YouTube and check out Avery Brooks as Captain Ben Sisko, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, as well as Nichelle Nichols, who played Lieutenant Uhura on the original Star Trek. And she's on the Smithsonian Channel and the Television Academy Channel. And she tells this incredible story about how she was offered a pre-Broadway musical role, and it actually was going to hand in her resignation to Roddenberry. And she just by chance met Martin Luther King, and he convinced her to stay on the show.
All right. So I've got two recommendations for you. One of them is a Netflix series which launched a while ago. And so it's called Glow. It's about women wrestling. I watched one or two episodes for getting ready for an appearance at the Bushnell with Mark Maron because I didn't know Maron's work that much. And then I just sort of put it aside. Well, I just watched the whole thing. And it's really, really – it's funny. It's also, you know, in the way that people try to be these days, it manages to do make some real commentary about human relations – About how people both do and don't get along. But it has some genuinely hilarious moments in it. I didn't really know too much about Alison Brie. I'm not somebody who – I've never really watched Community, I guess, which is where she shines. But she really shines in this. She is just a tremendous comic talent. And I also – like I got wrestling better. Like my son likes wrestling and I've never really quite understood the whole thing. And then I'm going to give a plug to a West Hartford Center restaurant. Not that West Hartford Center restaurants need any help from me. I should give a plug to a parking space Nero West Hartford restaurant instead. But Division West, which is a fairly new one there on LaSalle Road. My son and I ate there last night, and I'd had a little snack there after the movies, after going to see Molly's Game on Saturday night. It's really kind of nice. I believe the Division – yeah, Division West. Yeah, what did I call it, something else?
No, you got it right.
Yeah, Division West. It's I see the joke he's making on the computer. And I believe the chef is somebody who had something to do with peppercorns here in Hartford and headed on over there. So we really had some really good food there. So Division West, particularly if you can't get into one of the other restaurants. There were empty tables last night. You might be able to do it that way. I do want to thank everybody who helped out with this show today, including Jonathan McPants, who put the whole thing together. So lucky to have this terrific panel of Kate Russian, Tanisha Dugan, and Rich Holland. We will be back on Monday with a scramble where we are going to react to the news of the weekend, which for once I think I know what it's going to be, but that's a very dangerous thing to say in 2018.
Talk about Torrington, Vernon, Danbury, Waterbury, Oliveberry, Woodbury, hitting on New Britain, Vernon, I already said that one, Avon, Farmington, yeah.